This is Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Shaffer. Jennifer!
Richard!
How are you?
Hello.
Welcome to...
I am great. I'm doing fabulous.
You are? That's so exciting. And here we are on our 572,000th podcast. But who's keeping
count? I know. And welcome for your first time or your last.
That's right. This might be your first time or your last time listening in. And be careful if you're listening while you're driving.
Because I tend to put people to sleep.
Yeah, that's right. That's not why. It's because suddenly, like, I'm thinking about this one thing. And then, here comes a car in front of me.
Humana.
So what's going on, Jennifer? How you been?
Today feels so much better than Monday or Tuesday or Wednesday. And the reason why I feel is because there has been so much going on. Like I am so slammed. And when I have all my friends asking questions or they're needing help, I know that we're in trouble. Or when people that are in my industry come to me because they just need to be, you know, whatever. And I have to remind myself that it's not my chaos, that it's just everything else around, but it's going to work out. Like everybody that's going through all the stuff, all the things for the last 3 months, it's going to iron itself out. Yes, we had an earthquake. Woo! It woke me up. We have.
Yeah, that was fun, wasn't it?
The house went like this. And I'm like, oh my gosh. And my husband's like, oh, sweetie, the house is on rollers. We're good. It was built in. He's a developer. But still, and then the aftershocks, and then whatever. But
yeah, same here in Santa Monica. You know, we felt it. It woke us all up. And, you know, that's the thing about earthquakes now. It's like you yell, is everybody okay? Okay, back to sleep.
Back to sleep.
You know, we learned to take all the glass and everything off the walls so it doesn't bonk off your head.
That's true. Done the same thing. Yep.
All right. So why don't we dive into it? I'm sure that Luana might have something and Luana, for those tuning in, is our friend on the flip side, who is the moderator of our podcast over there. And Jennifer writes her name down dutifully before we get started. There she is. And, Luana, do you have anything you want to tell us? Or is there somebody on your clipboard that might want to come through and talk to us?
She just made me show like free fall. I'm like, but we do that every week. But she's making fun of us a little bit, I think.
What do you mean? She's showing you multiple images of people?
Well, she just showed me like free falling it or just going with it or whatever. So just give me a second. Okay. She gave me the word gratitude.
All right. Thank you very much. Gratitude for you on the flip side, Lou, or for us on this side of the veil?
All of this. If you're healthy, be grateful. If you have one family member that you like or love, be grateful. Or an animal or a pet, be grateful.
So she's saying be more grateful.
For
10 toes.
Gratitude.
Have gratitude. Go ahead.
That's so sweet. She says it's the quickest way to get you out of your own chaos. So the second you focus on what's right versus focusing on what's wrong, that loop in your head, like, and then she's mentioned, okay, I'm so proud of myself. I should have been doing this all along, but I realized that I needed to wake up doing meditation every day. I know there's a lot of people that do that. I started doing that and it was the quickest way out of whatever I felt was, because my chest felt heavy with all the stuff that was, all the things that was going on.
Yeah.
My clients and friends. And
so give us a 1, 2, 3. What do you do in terms of meditation for yourself? Just what do you do?
For myself, because I am fairly new at it. My husband got us what's called Muse, and it's a headband that you have to put on, and you can have sound baths. It helps you with your breathing, and it tells you when your mind goes. So it'll start thundering louder.
And that's cute.
When you calm your, it's instant.
That's interesting.
I do that and just your breathing, focusing just on the breathing that they tell you to, focusing on the breathing. And that tends to, that just does something for your brain. It does something to create endorphins. It just does. It works. And then, you know, we've been told this forever, right? And I do it from time to time, or I pray, you know, and then I'll go into, okay, what is it that, how can I help? And usually it's prayer or praying for people that need it, or, and however that looks to you, sending out good energy. It doesn't mean, or chanting. She actually says I've been very diligent.
You're a very diligent meditator. So for those of you not driving your car, one way to do it would be just to focus on your breathing. Mm-hmm. Do you visualize anything? You said you mentioned thunder. I understand that's when your thoughts are roaming, but.
Right. I visualize peace. Because when you are in that state, birds will start chirping to give you feedback that you're in that. Your mind's not. So I visualize love. Every time I focus on love, I get more birds on muse.
But I mean, do you focus on a person or just like a setting or a visual or the word love?
I just focus on the energy of love.
Okay.
What is it? Because as we know, whatever it is that you want, you have to give it away. So
whatever it is you want, you have to give it away
to match the frequencies.
Very good. It's a wonderful way to put it. Now, Luana, I know you have friends over there on the flip side who want to talk to us. And so
somebody recently. I don't know. She just says Chuck just showed up. So friends of Chuck.
Friends of Chuck. Okay. Well, this fella showed up. We'll give him that it's a male. Showed up in my kitchen, in my head, and heard him say, "Hey, I'm here." And I said, "Oh, okay. Well, you got to talk to Luana." And he goes, "I'm already talking to her." So, Luana, do you want to put that fella in a chair?
Am I going to know who it is?
Well, yeah, I think you would. Yeah, just put him in the chair, Lou. If he wants to talk to us now, he might have been just stopping by to say hello.
Was he a director?
No, the one I'm thinking about. I mean, Luana could be thinking about a director. I'm picking up my guitar. That's a hint.
Okay, I'm not going to play that game. Let me just go. Hold on. Okay, clearly he writes. So listen, I'm feeling him writing, like writing and directing whatever it is that he's doing. So you're talking about music. He's playing guitar. He's playing music.
Okay. For those who are driving, this is me playing the guitar. It's not just coming through really nilly.
No. Hold on. Does he have a name associated to you by chance? Or is there anything that deals with your name, Dick?
Well, let's put it this way. We've talked to friends of his before. He did just pass away.
I don't know who it is.
Okay, I'm going to tell you his first name, and let's see if that putt puts him in the chair. Okay. David.
Ah, because I was looking at Dick. Well, I wasn't looking at whatever.
Dick. Begins with a D. David.
I'm not going to make that fit, so it's Dick. I still don't know who it is.
Okay, well, let's just see if he'll talk to us a little bit. So, David, you want to tell, first of all, Luana, is this the person I'm thinking of? Is this the right person? Okay, so David, what was your experience?
I don't know who it is.
That's good. What, David, what was your experience crossing over? Who was there to greet you?
Ha! He said hell, actually.
That's that was your first experience. So what does that mean?
He was pushing. He didn't want to go. Ah. He was ready, but he wasn't ready. So hold on a second. He still felt like, hold on. His body definitely needed to go, but his mind definitely wanted to stay and felt like he had like 20 more years left.
Yeah, I think he was getting ready to go on a tour, actually, the day he passed. You know, still planning to do stuff. And so who was there to greet you when you crossed over?
My furry friends.
Your furry friends, okay, pets, friends. Animals.
And then, did he have a first wife?
I'm going to ask him, is it, so David, I need you to tell Jennifer if this is accurate. Are you talking about Christine? Or are you talking about a what? Another person?
Hold on. Sorry. Give me a second.
Okay.
For some reason, I'm allergic to something.
Oh, that's funny. I wonder if you're allergic to something on the flip side.
Maybe. I'm allergic to wrong information.
Well, it's not wrong yet. I mean, you know, it's okay that you don't know who this is. That's fine. We're just having a conversation with somebody that I know who he is. Luana knows who he is because she knew him.
Luana did. Okay.
Yeah.
Give me one follow-up. She knew him, David. David Crosby?
Yes.
Okay. She just told me as I walked away. I
couldn't walk. Okay.
Okay, so I didn't know. I don't. Is that the Grateful Dead? Now I sound really intelligent.
All right, now just repeat what you just said, please.
She just told me as I was walking away to turn off the heater that it was David Crosby.
Very good. That is the David I'm talking to. You don't know really who she is. That's great. Let's just start with that. I do. So I'm going to ask him some specific questions.
Oh, Crosby, Stills, and Nash, right?
Correct.
Okay.
So David.
And there's two out of the three that are over there, he says.
The other three are here. Okay, but he has quite a few friends over there. So, and we've interviewed a few.
I'm not gonna make that fit either. Just hold on a second. He says that there's two. So I just need to figure this out. Give me a second. Okay, now I'm sorry. I didn't know age gap. I'm already fighting with somebody. I'm like, I'm sorry. He's like, you didn't know who I was. I'm like, I'm sorry. Age gap. I'm sorry.
Age gap.
No. Okay, hold on. I'm asking for forgiveness. Give me a second. Oh, and did he have something in his chest? Was it his chest? Because it felt like he smoked. I don't know if he smoked a long time ago.
So let's not focus on that because everybody that's tuning in, well, they all know what happened with him because it's in
there. I don't know what happened.
But it's okay. That's all right. You don't. We're just going to ask him what it was like when he crossed over. Who was there to greet you? Was it friends? Was it strangers? What happened?
It was Jimi Hendrix.
Well, please describe what that was like. What happened?
It was a beautiful reunion, but I knew I was dead.
Was he on stage or was he out in a park or where was he?
He told me to go on stage. So it was one of those soft landings. But I knew I was being tricked. He says, I knew I was being tricked.
So give us the visual. Was it like a memory of your appearance on stage or?
It was when... Like he's showing me, and so is Luana, when they drove in a convertible, but not him. He was already there. Like something that was out either in the desert or something like, it almost felt like Burning Man kind of thing. Like that it was a big, it's something like that. That's what he was.
So he's, so it's like, I'm just to get a physical visual. He's in a convertible. He's driving through a desert somewhere. He's on his way to a concert. Is that correct?
Yes.
And then, and now look around the car. Who's in the car with you?
Who's the guy that's Billy's friend or the guy that was on Big Love?
Oh, Harry Dean Stanton?
Yeah, Harry Dean was in there.
Okay.
And then that's where the hell came from because he knew that he was before. Oh my gosh. I want to make sure I'm getting this right. Yeah, because he didn't believe in heaven. He didn't believe there was, you know, right?
Right. So, and so here's Harry Dean Stanton in a car, and you're like, oh, my God, it's Satan.
Oh, my God, it's Satan. We're going to hell. And so that's pretty reference for the hell aspect.
That's funny.
But it worked itself out instantly.
Instantly. You know. And so now, when did you, so now let's say you're walking on stage, how many musicians are on stage waiting for you, including Jimmy?
15. There's like 15 of us.
Like a whole crew of people. I see. And when you come out, and what was the song you guys played?
You want to put it? You showed me Band-Aid. You know that song, Band-Aid?
I don't know the song, but.
Hey, not Band-Aid, but it was all the musicians. It was a Christmas, like.
Oh, yeah. Like they sang, Do They Know It's Christmas?
Yeah.
That song, like
I think,
that.
I think the group was called Band. I don't know how they organized it or whatever.
Yeah, no, that was the concert was called Band-Aid. Yeah, okay. That's correct.
All right. And you know, if somebody asked me that question, there's no way I could come up with that.
Yeah, like, no. Right. So they're all performing. Can David, would you tell, was it one of your songs or was it somebody else's song?
It was one of my songs, one of the earlier ones. And it was mainly, I did a guitar solo.
And can you put it in Jennifer's
mind? I had a bunch of backup.
Would you put it in Jennifer's mind what the lyrics were? She may not know the song, but I might.
Hold on. I just saw somebody that I read that was lives up in PV. We've talked like.
Oh, like a musician.
No, I know it's a musician.
No, somebody that.
Musician.
Yeah, no, I understand. I know what you're talking about. You read somebody who is a musician who.
Was a famous musician who knows all the musicians.
All those people over there. Well, I'm going to say a few of their names and I'm going to ask him because he knew everybody.
Yeah.
So have you seen, I'm going to ask you, have you seen Mama Cass?
Yeah, I worked through, I guess she was in the back. Yes.
And have you seen Christine Hinton?
Right away. She was one of the first.
Okay. Now Jennifer doesn't know who she is. I do. And what was that like to see Christine?
He swore at her. He's like, what the fuck did you do?
Okay. Jennifer doesn't know what happened, but Christine.
He got mad at her. He's like, I told you not to do it. Or I told you not to like whatever. And he was so mad. He like the mad turned into mad love. Cause I missed out on the time. She just showed me all the things that needed to happen or all the things that she like, he's like, I calmed down instantly, but because I wanted to smack her.
So for the audience tuning in, Christine was his girlfriend who died in a car accident in Marin County. She went into to the grocery store and never came back. And it sent him into a tailspin, which included drugs and a lot of heroin,
that's
stuff like
it.
That.
So maybe it was her doing that to him.
So that in other words, seeing her and realizing, I mean, so it's that odd thing of chastising someone that you love. But it's just wonderful for you to be able to say that. So, but if other people that you saw that have you seen Ethan?
You know what's so fucking cool? Sorry. Ooh, now it's explicit. You know what's so cool? He showed me taking her and them going, you know how Uma Thurman in Killing Bill? I think Killing Bill, not Killing Bill, but.
Kill Bill.
Whatever. When she, the time where she got shot in the heart, but
Pulp
before
Fiction.
They were doing Pulp Fiction and they were going around, like you could see them dancing. Going around dancing. Like he's showing me like taking Christine's hand and then just like nobody else is in the room, even though everyone else is in the room and just swinging around how
beautiful
excited they were to be together.
To be together again.
And he's showing me how like this world is so like a grain of sand compared to all the worlds that they've been together with, like a part of.
Wow.
And magnificent. He's like, it's better than any song, better than any lights. He's like, better than any feeling you could have when you're with somebody that just rocked your world in every single way. But then you realize the bigger play or the bigger part of what the rippling effect that it has with everything, including us talking about it right now.
Beautiful. Beautifully said. Thank you, sir. I'm going to ask you about some people that I've read about I didn't know about. Your brother, Ethan. Have you had a chance to see him?
He was young.
He died younger.
Yeah, he said that.
What was that like to see Ethan?
Sad, but rejoicing. Again, he goes, I go into the like, oh, how did this happen? Did I I should have done more. I should have done more for you. I should have done more. I'm so sorry. That's what he keeps saying. And he goes,
see, and so Jennifer doesn't know why he's saying that. I do. It's because Ethan took his own life. Okay. So
it felt like that.
But it's that aspect of seeing someone that you love.
And he just, so he's showing me, like going up to him and just saying, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. I should have done more. I should have paid attention. I was in my own shit. I was in my own shit. And immediately he said, because it's not talking, those are just feelings. The overwhelming amount of love that just embodied him to shut him up. He said, it's like it wrapped and wrapped and wrapped around me. And he showed me how I actually kept him alive longer than he would have been. That he just, it was nobody's fault. His brother is saying he just couldn't live in his own skin. It wasn't your fault. You didn't know I was bipolar and had schizophrenia and all this other stuff tagged on to it, which was not diagnosed. One of them was, but not the rest. And then he medicated himself, he said.
Wow.
He's saying he really didn't try to, like, he took his own life, but he didn't know he did.
I see. I understand. Okay. And well, David, let me ask you about your father. Have you had a chance to see him? Now, who punched who? Did Floyd punch you, or did you punch Floyd?
He goes, we both had a wrestling match. It was equal.
Wonderful.
It's equal. Equal. He goes, equal craziness, equal sassiness, or whatever, without that word, but that's the only way I can describe what he's showing me. He goes, met with an abundance of laughter because of all of the shenanigans and all of the things we thought we got away with. He goes, just bit us in the ass. He goes, let me tell you, watch it. Oh my goodness. He goes, hold on. When you get your life review, he showed me, he goes, mine was like, vroom. He goes, I'm going as high as I could go and then drop. And then it's high. He's just showing me the roller coaster.
So the roller coaster of a life review, and what he's referring to is what people say is after we check off the planet, we have this life review and we get to see and experience all the things that we did and the highs of the really wonderful things that we did and the lows of the really tragic things that we did. We get to experience all of those.
And he says, though, but oh, this is so cool. Hold on. He goes, but the roller coaster ends and you're at the same level as you were when you started. He goes, it doesn't matter. He goes, it's a lot more exciting, all the highs and the lows and the dips and the turts, you know, curtsies or whatever he was saying. He goes, you end up in the same place. He goes, that's where people need to get it straight. He goes, the roller coaster eventually goes straight.
So what are you saying, David, do more, have more entertaining life, do stuff that you are afraid of?
He's like, stop being boring.
Stop being boring. Very good. You didn't, I don't think anything about your life was boring. Or was it? Tell
on
us.
On purpose. He said I was, because my life was extraordinary.
And so, listen, there were a lot of, people are going to ask about it, bad blood between you and other members of your different bands. Do you want to address that at all? Because I can just ask you real specific questions. If you have anything to say to Roger.
He said no. He goes, we'll use Jennifer because Jennifer doesn't know anything about me, apparently. So
there you go. That's right.
He's like, bring it.
So how about your friend Jim, who went by the name Roger?
Asshole.
Anything for him? Asshole. Okay, very good.
He goes, I don't blame him. It's not his fault.
Not his fault. How about your friend Steven?
He said it was a manager that effed that up.
Okay, that screwed up your relationship. Okay, money. What about your friend Steven?
He's like, tell him to get his big boy britches on.
Tell him to get his big boy britches on. How about your friend Graham?
He's like, I'm glad we were friends when we were young, because I certainly didn't like him later.
Okay.
There's good times. He said that he goes, we spoke completely different languages. Like, he's just showing me, and then he showed me, it's just like Republicans and Democrats or whatever. They can't hear each other. He goes, we never heard each other afterwards. And he goes, and he really was hard of hearing. And I was stubborn.
So he really was hard of hearing and I was stubborn. That's brilliant. Listen, these three guys that I just mentioned, you did such great harmonies with. Graham, Nash.
Isn't that a conundrum? Or isn't that a double entendre? Like, or not a double entendre, but the fact that...
Yeah, the idea that you could be...
And our frequencies were just... Rah!
Just fantastic. Some of the best ever done. There was also a guy named Neil, a friend of yours named Neil, Canadian fella who showed up and also played with you. Do you want to tell anything you want to mention to say to Neil?
Thank you. He pulled me out of a dark place.
Thank you. Pulled me out of a dark place. That's lovely to say. And what was it like seeing Luana? Because Luana introduced me to you.
He kind of wanted to keep me there too, though.
Oh, Neil wanted you to keep me. Why? Because you guys were on a tour? Or?
I don't know. He was just laughing. I'm like, stop laughing, David. Like, what? Show me. Well, by the way, how old are you right now? Oh, he's 52. I know he's not that. He was like 84 when he...
81, yeah.
Okay, something
so,
like
but
that.
He's saying inside, yeah. He's always felt about 52.
Well, right now he's showing up like he's 52.
I see, okay.
Like the wisdom of 52, he's like, it's wasted on the young, but I like the wisdom of that, you know, whatever. I feel like he might have gotten his shit together. Well, he says he did when he was 30, but I don't believe him. But go on.
Well, Neil Young was somebody that was, and so that's an interesting way to put it, that he helped him, saved him. And I address it that way just to, you know, to be fair and whatever. We have some, well, tell me about Luana. Luana introduced me to you.
Bittersweet. I was crazy about that girl. I'm crazy about her.
What do you think about this thing we're doing?
I wasn't thrilled. That's your next question. He's like, I wasn't really thrilled about talking to you guys clearly with how you responded to me when I first showed up. I'm sorry. He's still like taking offense to it. There's nothing.
Well, nothing to be offended about. It's just I don't have the words that Jennifer does. I can say, let's talk later.
But also, it was supposed to happen like that to show everybody. I'm like, we don't talk about what's going to happen.
Yeah, we had no idea what we were going to talk about.
No idea. And sometimes they have to block me. And I didn't know. I don't want, like, I don't pay attention. And
I have to be honest, just prior, I thought maybe he'll show up because he did last week. And so I did a little cursory, you know, research.
Good.
So let's talk about...
He showed up last week?
Yeah, right after he passed, just like an hour later, I was in the kitchen
heard him say... I thought you meant last week's podcast. I'm like, oh, what?
Well, let me ask you, who were you surprised to see over on the flip side, if anyone?
Elvis.
Okay, very good. We've had
not for that reason, but just give me a second.
Go ahead.
He's like, I was surprised to see how much I missed his big personality. And he said that seeing Christine, is it?
Mm-hmm.
Like that, he's just showing me hearts all around. Like that's when you know you're in heaven. When you're with somebody you love so much. And then the whole gratitude thing, thank you, Luana. She's showing me that she's like, everyone has something to be grateful for, whether it's being able to breathe, because you know, that's a thing, not breathing, right? COVID, the whole thing.
Yeah.
That's the thing. If you have nine fingers, be grateful for it. Like if you have like whatever it is, it gets you out of that mode of focusing on things that are not serving you well. Because whatever you put your attention to, your body reacts the way that you think. So put it to something good and joyous and then give it away, give it out. And the best, that's so funny. I don't know who's showing that to me. The best things in life are free.
Hey, that could be a song. I've got a question for you, David. Go ahead.
John Lennon. Wow. Yeah.
So talk to us about that experience.
We sang the Yellow Submarine. That's funny. And they utilize that as like their class. Like it's the Yellow Submarine. Like everybody's in it. They get to just go around. That's so funny. There's got to be more meanings with that. I don't know.
So you guys sang Yellow Submarine together? Or you just thought about
it? On stage. He showed up and we sang.
On stage and singing that together.
Yeah. Yes.
In the town where I was born. And so it, so I just,
that's actually pretty, I don't know the words.
Yeah.
Again, age gap, but there's that song has a lot of meaning to being back there, I think. Like in a town, like if you're with your friends that come in, the people.
Oh, where I was born.
Yeah.
Many more of them live next door. And the and they traveled around in this yellow bubble of a yellow submarine, underground, under the water.
Thought bubbles. He's like going like this to thought bubbles. That's
very
so
good. Funny. So there's a connection there between yellow submarine and what we're doing right now. It's fascinating. I have a question about somebody named Robert. Now, I don't know if you're going to show Jennifer who I'm talking about. Maybe you don't know who I'm talking about.
Well, I did. Is it Robert Town? That's my first go-to.
No, yeah, that would be our first. That's our friend Robert. No, I'm thinking about Robert Kennedy because I know you did a lot on his behalf when he was alive. And then go ahead. What did, have you talked to him? Have you seen him?
Well, he just laughed because a lot of good that did. It just got completely unwound. Sorry. Hold on a second. Yeah. Hold on. You can't tell me to calm down. He's like, you calm down, personal answer. They can't do it. Like, that's not.
Well, we're excited to talk to you, David. So please.
He's just joking around. I know, but it's so funny. He goes, you did the same thing. He goes, you're very dynamic. Hold on. He's like, who gave you Cheerios this morning? I'm like, again, that's an age thing. Hold on. He's like, stop reminding me of age. We're timeless over here.
That's funny. Very good.
Hold on. He says that they discussed how close they were to doing some more incredible things. They were so close to doing some bigger things than what they did, even though they did a lot. And did anything have to do with Africa as well?
It's very possible. It could have been African Americans as well. Because
it felt like it had to do with military, something like military.
Oh, but the Vietnam War, you know, that's getting out of there. Yeah. Okay, very good. And, you know,
because we keep on repeating patterns that should not be repeating. But
you would think. But since the dawn of time, I imagine. But I knew that you were a fan, and I just wondered if you guys had met up. And so, David, you have family, you have your wife who's grieving for you, your widow, Jan. And you have, go ahead.
Dick Cheney just showed up and he's showing me you in my mind's eye. So I don't know if there's any correlation to have you.
Is he saying I look like Dick Cheney? Is that what the issue is?
No. Dick Cheney showed up over there.
No, he's not over there. He's still here.
Okay, then Maverick. Who's Maverick?
Oh, John McCain. Very good.
Stop doing that to me.
Oh, you know why it is? Because when we talk about one politician, let's say Robert Kennedy, a service, then sometimes it opens that frequency for that other people. So John McCain, please, of course, you're well. Were you a fan of David's music?
Well, he has to say yes because he's right there.
I was going to say, you can go ahead, try to say no. But what do you want to interject something into our conversation here?
He says he's commenting on the fact that we have made progress because we take care of our prisoners of war.
I love it when people on the flip side argue or discuss with other people on the flip side to correct what they were just saying.
And they so, asked me to do it.
Yeah, they're asking you to do it. I mean, David's saying we haven't really progressed. We're still Stone Age. And John comes in and says, no, actually, we have progressed. So that's kind of hilarious. You guys are going to have to duke that out later. So I'm asking Dave, John, you're going to have to step aside, buddy. This is David's spotlight.
He knows.
So you're, thank you, sir. And thank you for your service. I saw that your daughter is, I think she just had a kid or something. So congratulations on that. You're a grandpa again. So
that kid got named a name that's associated to him.
Oh, very good. Lovely. Yeah. So, David, your widow Jan. I don't know her, but I know she's you guys have been.
She dealt with me for years. She's a.
I was just gonna say that you guys were together since the 80s.
Yeah. So she knows what's up. She felt it. She begged me to go get help. He said that he couldn't. I have no idea how he passed. I don't know what, you know. He's like, I had heart shit.
Don't we all? But I mean, I understand. And listen, bless your heart. So,
he says that he's already visited her.
That was my question.
I know.
Hold on. Is she aware of that or?
Not really, because she thinks she's thinking it in her head because she's grieving.
Let me ask you, why not? Because we have you.
I'm going to miss this little shit.
What's a way for her to suggest? Can you suggest something that'll be unique to her that only she'll understand? Like the flower or a bird or some cologne or perfume or something in your house?
I just thought something, but I'm not going to mention it. Just give me a second.
He's such a naughty interviewee.
It's her underwear. I don't know. I'm not going to look into it. I just know I'm not thinking it.
Okay.
At this point, I'm not going to fight him anymore.
What is it? I mean, what is it about it? Is it a unique shape or something? Or is that just something, a joke you guys have between you?
It's almost like now she can wear her own underwear, or now she can wear whatever she wants, or something like that. I don't know.
Okay. Oh, no. It's like a private joke. Like he wore her underwear once or something. And then
I don't know, but I just know that I'm not thinking it. And right. She's such a trooper and such, she's like, she knew what she signed up for. And she's the whole reason why I could be a Magoo and do whatever I want. He's just be quiet. He's showing me with my own husband how.
Oh, okay. Well, I mean, listen, this is why we do this. We don't know the answer. He does. You've shared it. His wife runs across this in some fashion. He'll know that that's very specific. And, she may believe it or not, that's out of our hands. I know you had a son that passed away. I think his name is Beckett. And have you had a chance to see him?
Right away, he said.
What was that like?
He told me how much it meant to him, how I didn't interfere with his passing. So if Beckett was sick or mentally sick, or I don't know, like he was allowed.
I think it was an illness, but I know.
So that's what I'm getting to. But he says that thank you for, because he wanted to get all the doc. He wanted him to, he wanted to do something that he would live longer, but be in pain. And so his son said, thank you for letting me go the way I wanted to go.
Oh, wow. That's
not
beautiful.
Stopping me from doing that. And he says that because the guilt that his dad had about not feeling like he did, like having all these resources and not getting it figured out. He goes, the love, again, all the heart bubbles that go around the love was just spectacular with him. And I knew instantly that I followed what I was supposed to, but it's reassuring when you get over there. He's also making fun of me, like when we've talked about past life situations, he's also making fun of me saying, you can't prove it, but wait till you get over there.
I know you've been working with your son, James, on music and stuff. I saw a video of that the other day. Sorry. You have to go. Oh, I'm sorry. All right. Well, listen, before you go, let's let David have the floor once more. Anything you want to say to your fans, your friends, or your family, my friend? Thank you for stopping by.
Music. Play music while you're not harboring that loop of what's going wrong. He says, play music to things that you love or hold on, show me again. I know. He's like, I just got over here. I'm still learning how to. Oh, he said, play music and love all the small things in between. Like what we talked about early, that's the loop, bringing it back to gratitude.
Bring it back to gratitude and use music to show your gratitude.
use music, make your own music, play your own, play music, sing along, dun, dun, dun. And then, and because what it does is a vibration that makes other people happy. That's why going to music festivals, that's why going to concerts, you're with the energy of everybody being excited about it. He goes, normally everybody's excited about it.
You who are on the road must have a code that you can get by. Teach your children well. Their father's hell will slowly go by. That's his song.
I'm sure it is.
Thank you, David. Thank you, Jennifer. Thank you for your gifts. And Luana, thanks for allowing us to have this kind of unusual venue to talk to people that we know and love no longer on the planet.
All right. Bye.
Bye. Bye. Love, love.
Love, love.
This has been Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Shaffer. For more information, jennifershaffer.com, martinizone.com, or richmartini.com. Hacking the Afterlife documentary is available on Gaia.com via Amazon Prime.